Since childhood, I have been fascinated with language. I've invented my own.
Tell me a story in any language you want.
It's a story
about magic beyond anything anyone has ever felt before.
What is it that you think is timeless about Tolkien's work? Like, it's always something that people seem to be eager to revisit.
I think it feels so real, and that's that, you know, is a testament to how creative and in depth his knowledge and understanding of language and the worlds he created were. You know, when it's completely immersive, his work. So that's something that whatever age you read it at, and luckily for me, going back to revisit it, to research this, I appreciated it in a whole new way.
I think his love of language and his love of magic and fantasy is something that people are always going to resonate with because it's a form of escapism. And Edith got that out of his storytelling, and it was a way for her to really leave her present existence. You know, she was a woman of the time. She was an orphan. She had a very specific social standing and didn't have many prospects. And so this allowed her the ability to disappear. And I think we love the ability to go somewhere else for a little while in our heads. And his stories allow us to do that.
His incredible capability to create a world out of nothing. Yeah. To be as imaginative as he is and to see it in such vivid technicolor and then to be able to bring it to life. Yeah.
A few authors have had the sort of cultural impact that Tolkien has had.
And to be able to incorporate such human stories at the middle of a fantastical world. You know, you feel like you could know those characters, and yet it's a tree. It's Treebeard.
Treebeard.
You think you've met him before.
Anthony's favourite character, Treebeard.
Love him. Oh, really?
Love him, love him.
And how about you guys? What are your favourite Lord of the Rings characters?
Oh, good question.
A question I wish I'd asked everyone else, but you're special. You got that question exclusively.
Thank God as well. Yeah. I think my favourite would be Aragorn.
Ooh. I'm a Gimli man.
Yeah.
Through and through. Die hard.
Now, what was the most surprising thing that you learned researching Edith's life and just the whole Tolkien sort of mythos?
Well, there's very little to be known about Edith or the fact that she even existed. I wasn't aware of her. But I didn't know that she was an orphan like him. I think that was something that they bonded over right away and that they had each other to rely on for encouragement, and I loved that story. I loved their love story, and that it inspired so much of the stories that we now know.
Ooh, there was lots of fun little things like that. Him and Edith, his longtime love, would throw sugar cubes in people's hats when they went for tea, and then he stole a bus. He was arrested for stealing a bus when he was younger at Oxford. I mean, but I just didn't know anything about the man really behind the legends. So it was a steep learning curve. I was mispronouncing his name, to be honest with you. I was saying Tolkien. So I quickly realized that that was not the right pronunciation. I had to say Tolkien. And then it's learning about those relationships that kind of gave him a safe environment to create in and inspired him to then tell the stories he did.
I honestly didn't know anything about his life before this. I mean, you hear of him all the time, and I knew all his work and everything, but to then learn that he lived such an incredible life and that he fought in the war, and I was kind of blown away.
Yeah, I had no idea that he was orphaned at such a young age. Didn't know he fought in the war. I didn't know that he stole a bus. You know, you find all these things that this guy was just a young, you know, a young man like all of us, you know, the trials and tribulations, going through his own story, and it was just a treat to, you know, go. He wasn't just, you know, an old dusty professor scribbling in the books. He was like a real human being and a real man, you know.
In preparing for a role like this or any other sort of biopic, what do you think is the most challenging aspect to sort of get down packed?
Well, for me, it was a little different because there's no real footage of her. There's not many photos. So it's not like people can really compare what they know to be true of her and then me. But I think in general, when you are playing someone who has a public persona that people already know of, mannerisms, making sure that innately they seem or you seem to have understood their aura, you know, and kind of just the the character in general of how they acted when you can directly compare it to a video to video footage or photos is always going to be difficult because people have a preconceived idea walking in.
The hardest job of researching the character, it's weird because obviously people have preconceptions when you're playing real people. It's different though when you're playing someone who, you know, there's interviews with him later in life, but there isn't footage or anything of him when he was younger. So that actually gives you a fair amount of freedom where you kind of read the story you're telling and then capture as many different tidbits of information you can from his work and from biographies and from watching later recordings and things, and then you're kind of free to just tell this story and try and capture the essence of who you think he might have been.
Is there anybody that you're looking forward to, like anyone you would want to play in a film version of their lives? Because I see that you've done, you're starting to sort of do more biopic work between this and
weirdly,
the Bundy film.
I know, yeah. It's interesting. I don't know yet. I didn't know of Edith's story, I didn't know of Liz's story, you know, for Extremely Wicked. And both of those stories were so inspiring, and I was, those are two women of countless that we don't know their story. So I don't know yet, but I do enjoy getting to voice a story that hasn't been told yet. So there'll definitely be more to come.
Dark Phoenix is coming up. Mm-hmm. It closes out the latest cycle of X-Men films. Yep. How are you feeling about that right now? Like, are you ready to say goodbye to Beast? Do you feel like there's more you want to do? Like, where are you at with that?
Where am I at with that? I'm excited to see this movie. I haven't seen it yet, but I love the script that Simon Kinberg wrote, and I love working with him as a director as well. And I think the performances and things that I saw happening on set were very exciting in terms of how this movie's going to be. And also, I got to take the Beast Hank McCoy role to kind of new areas in this film. So that's something that if it is the last time I play him, then I'm glad I got to do that.
Well, I certainly hope it isn't, because you've been a great sort of counterpart to Kelsey Grammer's like older Beast.
Hey, thank you.
Like, I just feel the two just meld so well together.
I watched a lot of Frasier and kind of studied him a little bit in the build up to it, so appreciate that.
Well, gentlemen, before we go, yes, as promised, we're going to close out with a great big rousing Hellheimer on the count of three.
Yeah.
All right, one, two, three.
Hellheimer!
Hellheimer! Tolkien! Let's call the whole thing off. Gentlemen, thank you so much!
Yeah!
I want Scorpius Malfoy!
Oh, guys, you've been
You're a legend.
Absolute best.
You're a legend.
Thank you.